here, make sure it's up on the lid.
Spears, could you please state your name and your record?
Yes, I'm John Spears.
I won't go over some previous issues, but if we could go into your credentials. Are you a practicing attorney?
I am. I'm a member of the State Bar of Georgia. I graduated from Emory in 76 and started practice in June of 76, and I have practiced continually since then as a civil attorney.
What is your particular area of practice?
After the first 8 or 9 years, when I met a young lawyer who did pretty much everything that came in the door, I started specializing in estate, probate, trust, litigation, and I concentrated on that and mediation in that area for the last 25 or 30 years.
You're with Spears & Spears. How long have you been with that firm?
Basically, since my wife, Melanie Spears, got out of law school about 20 years ago. We changed John W. Spears Jr. PC to Spears & Spears PC.
Are you licensed in Georgia?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about some of your credentials. Are you a member of any bar committees or organizations?
Well, obviously, I'm a member of the State Bar of Georgia, a member of the Atlanta Bar Association. I have been a member of the DeKalb Bar Association, but we're sort of winding down our practice, and I just did not renew my DeKalb bar dues. I've been a member of the Fiduciary Law Section of the State Bar, member of the State Planning and Probate Section of the Atlanta Bar Association, and members of the Dispute Resolution Section of those.
Are you rated by Mark Dillon?
Yes, sir. I have an AV rating from Mark Dillon.
Are you a member of any honorary organizations?
I am. I've been elected a fellow of the American College of Trust and State Council, known as ACTEC.
Are you a super lawyer?
I don't think so right now. It was from the beginning until last year. I was in fiduciary litigation, and then when I sort of withdrew from the litigation, they sort of left me off.
Well, how many years were you? Let me ask a better question. How many years were you in the super lawyer?
12 or 13, I'm not sure which.
Let me track through some exhibits here that I think will help you walk through. I wanted to start with something that is actually already in evidence as Fredy's exhibit one. It is our plaintiff's exhibit 15. I think it's Fredy's. Well, it's Fredy's exhibit 2, excuse me. This is plaintiff's exhibit 15. I'm going to ask you to recognize that document.
Yes.
What is it?
This letter, the letter dated May 27, 2014, that I sent to Harvard Caldwell, Jeremy Meester, and Michael Deaver by mail and email regarding these two estates.
Okay, and I don't want to duplicate.
I have that record. Okay. May 27, 2014 letter, Spears letter.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay.
It's our exhibit 15 and it's Fredy's exhibit 2.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a true and accurate copy of that letter?
Yes, it is.
Okay. I'm going to move to admit Fredy's exhibit 15.
We don't object to this. It's already in
it. It's already in this, but admit it.
Tell us about the circumstances that led to your draft.
Well, when you employed me, one of my first jobs was to look into find out what had happened in the estates, what was going on, and to try to do two things. One was to go ahead and respond to the demand that you make some decisions on these creditor claims now that there was money in the estate, and to kind of propose a way to see if we couldn't get going on the case.
Now, on page 4 of the exhibit, I see a number of itemized numbers down here. It appears to be
This first one was regarding the responding to the claims from Maria Kingery. And it's her creditor claim for $16,626.06. And the first thing we said was there's about $1,400 worth of this claim for reimbursement that you were denied. You were denying because it was based on payments from an account to which rent had been collected and deposited for the estate.
When you say rent was collected and deposited for the estate, is that being collected and specified to lawyers being paid by Mr. Casada?
Yes, it was. And these were things that happened. This was collections before you were involved as administrator of the estate. The second thing was there were three or four things that said there was about $2,600 worth of expenses that were conditionally denied, but if you can show us the documents that say that it's really tied to the estate in an appropriate way, then you reconsider. The last thing was $12,569.69. It said we're conditionally approving these, but we would like to see the supporting documentation for it. And then over on the next page, you conclude and said, you know, please give us the supporting documentation within 10 days, and, you know, that's where you were going with it.
With regards to Maria's claims, did she give you any supporting documentation? Or can I give you any supporting documentation within 10 days?
No, I don't think we got the supporting documentation that was requested until, basically until Mr. Beggs was retained shortly before we had a declaratory judgment hearing.
Now, going down on page 5, Freddie's creditor, if you could explain the court those entries there.
Freddie Alvarez, by the way, Maria Kingery's client was on the Graciela Alvarez estate. Freddie Alvarez's claim was on his father's estate, Federico Alvarez's estate, and basically, you approved conditionally $13,734.98 of a $13,898.98 claim, and then you conditionally disapproved a payment to the Fulton County Probate Court, which was basically the same kind of thing you disapproved of for Maria Kingery. And you asked for, we've asked for supporting documentation to support the claims that he made.
Did he supply, or his attorney supply, any supporting documentation at any point?
Yes. And I point out, at the bottom of page 5, there's a footnote regarding addressing the joint account claim. Mrs. Kingery had said, and I understood, had said that Freddie had, that there was a joint account that Freddie had with his father. I'm sorry, Freddie Alvarez had with his father. And she said that that account was for convenience and should be considered in part of the estate. And we said there that based on the information that was available to you, there was not sufficient evidence in your judgment to overcome the presumption that in the banking code that if two names are on an account, it's presumed to be a joint account of survivorship unless there is clear and convincing evidence of contrary intent at the time the account's opened. And we had not seen anything to show to overcome that clear and convincing evidence requirement.
To your recollection, did we ever receive anything from Maria or our attorneys regarding that?
No. I mean, we did hear that everybody knows, it's common knowledge that this was for convenience, but I never saw anything that met what I would consider to be an evidentiary standard to overcome that.
Now, you also made some reference in your letter on page 6 to the Lanier Place property, and I think you look in the last paragraph of that, you're talking in practicality about how the proceeds of that would ultimately go down to the heirs. Can you explain that?
Well, you know, if they each own property 50-50, then the first one to die with no will, the property goes to the wife, and then the third each to the two children. And then when the wife, which would have been Graciela, passes away, everything goes to the two children. In both instances, it's subject to any administrative expenses, but just from a, sorry for the cliche, but a 1,000-foot view, the only people who were heirs of the estate, ultimately, were Fredy Alvarez and Maria Kingery, and they were going to get, they were going to get things 50-50.
Now, as part of this letter, I see on page 6, there's a section on the proposal for an interim distribution. Can you explain to the court the purpose of that proposal?
Well, in a way, it was kind of a, it's almost like a peace offering. It's kind of saying, well, it looks like we've got, from Frederico's out, from Frederico's estate, we could distribute $28,000 to Fredy Alvarez, $28,000 to Maria Kingery, and $28,000 to Graciela Alvarez estate. We still have money in the Federico estate to cover claims and anything else that came up, including extra compensations. But the idea was, my idea at least at first was, let's see if we can take these two estates and move them down into just one estate, because everybody's going to be 50-50.
This proposal for an interim distribution was not an offer to apply anything to these other clients.
It was just, we think in this one estate, we have some additional funds, and we can make distributions to an equal distribution based on the one-third, one-third, one-third. We thought we could, I thought we could distribute, I guess it would have been $84,000.
Where at that time, did anybody accept, or was there an interim distribution made?
There was no interim distribution made.
Do you remember why? Did any of the heirs, Maria or Fredy, object to that?
Well, I know that fairly early on, Maria King, Maria Kingery objected to any distribution. She said that the state court case was going on, and that she and her mother's estate had claims against her brother, and that until that state court case was decided, she would object to any distribution in either estate.
I'm going to show you what has been marked as Plaintiff's Exhibit 16. Let me move on and I'll show you that. Do you recognize that?
Yes, plaintiff's exhibit 17 is an email that I received from Mrs. Kingery on dated May 27, 2014 at 3:35 p.m. I'm in our 10-minute chapter, the one we just talked about.
Is this a true and accurate copy of the email that you received from Ms. Kingery?
It is.
Move to amend exhibit 17.
Objections. No objections.
No objections. Admitted.
Tell us, if you would, the substance of this letter.
Well, it says this isn't my final answer, but I haven't stated all the objections I have. I'm going to retain somebody to represent me in the probate matters. And the deed with the live estate, which is the right estate, the quitclaim deed we were talking about earlier, is very much a part of the litigation, and no decision will be made. And there's an objection with supporting documentation to Freddie's claims, and that she wants to seek a ruling from the probate court on that and all other matters pending. And she still wants her documents within 2 days.
Take a look at that. Can you identify that guy?
Claims Exhibit 18 is a two-page email that I sent to Mrs. Kingery on May 29th, 2014, about 11 in the morning.
What is the substance of this? I see you have subdivided into different categories, requests for copies and amendments. You can explain each one of those segments.
Well, the first thing I need to say is, why I'm an attorney representing you, why am I writing an individual party? I had contacted Caldwell and Watson to determine what was going on. You know, when I got your petition to require the court to order you to make a payment of a claim caused you to employ me, I contacted Jeremy Meeser and asked him for an extension of time to respond instead of just gotten involved. And I'd like to see where to go. Well, I heard slightly later, that they were going to not be representing her anymore. And the first part of this thing is that Caldwell and Watson have advised that they're withdrawing from representing you, and they've given me permission to deal directly with you until you hire somebody else. So that's why I wrote this to her instead of to one of her attorneys. So they got three emails from her on the afternoon of May 27th. The three parts are, you ask for copies of checks, you demanded time and expense records, and we were talking about a proposed interim distribution in my letter a few days earlier.
I see you reference in the second paragraph a request for copies that the administrator does not have the originals of any of these documents. What are you referring to there?
Well, I think the first email I got from her, or the second one really, because I didn't attach the first one, but basically said, he's got everything, he meaning you. And part of that was to say, look, all we have is copies, and we don't have, my client does not have everything. And I said, if you didn't keep your original bank records, then you need to please go get them from your attorneys, or we can make copies of what we have. But that would be at your expense. The second thing was, you want me to go on?
Yeah, go ahead and demand time and expense records.
Okay, well, this was a theme throughout the case. She felt that you were an attorney and that you should be able to have your time and expense records. I felt that you are an attorney who is serving as an administrator, and the only way you get paid is by approval of the court. So what I told her was that you had not taken any fee or compensation or commission or extra compensation, and really at this point you hadn't decided what you were going to do about that. And so I kind of tracked through some of the expenses you've had, because towing expenses, a courier charge of $175 each to Randy Galanti, and you paid me $3,500. But you, basically what I was saying is you will not get these records until the records that you want of his time and expenses until he petitions the court for fees.
And then on the proposed interim distribution, I see you address that issue. This is just follow-up to the letter.
Yeah, it was all follow-up to the letter. But basically what I, you know, remember I had said we should make one-third, one-third, one-third distributions from Federico Alvarez's estate. And I was just reminding her here, you know, that was a distribution, proposed interim distribution from an estate against which you had not asserted any claims. And it would have been a, I didn't see there was any reason not to make that distribution. But, and last thing I said is a recommendation on top page, please retain counsel to represent you in these matters.
At that time, did she get counsel?
No. I think the next counsel in this case was Mr. Beggs, shortly before the declaratory judgment hearing.
So at this time, she was pro se.
Well, that was the only way I could communicate with him.
Let me show plaintiff's exhibit. Sorry, did I admit that one? That's 18. This is plaintiff's exhibit 19. Take a look at that exhibit. You recognize this exhibit?
Yes, this is an email I received from Mrs. Kingery. It was dated May 29th, 2014 at 2:46 p.m.
Is this a true and accurate copy of that email?
It is.
Move to admit exhibit 19.
Any objection?
No objection.
No objection, Judge.
All right, admit it.
If you could tell the court, what is the substance of this email?
Well, I guess from my perspective, we're sort of starting to see things fly out of hand. My general intention, my intention with the May 29th letter was to say, let's calm down, let's be reasonable, let's just let me tell you what I think is going on. And at this point, she's saying, she basically comes back and says everything she said before. It's like nothing I said made a difference, but that she was, she seemed to feel like under the demand for time and expense records is that she's an heir and a beneficiary, and she's entitled to a regular statement of hourly fees and expenses in order to review it and see if she thinks it's necessary. Again, she objected to the any distribution pending resolution of litigation. She objected to paying me any fees. And at this point, she's saying, middle of page two, it's clear to me that Mr. Hamberg is not only abusing his power as executive of his administrator, but is unable to be impartial, appears to have undertaken a personal vendetta to force me to spend money, and so on. He's incurring attorney's fees. And then she says at the end, I'm placing Mr. Hamberg on notice that I, as an heir and beneficiary of my parents' estates, will be filing a grievance with the State Bar of Georgia requesting the bar investigate his conduct, which I consider to be unethical and abusive. This has escalated pretty quickly. And this is the kind of thing you have to respond to.
This was on May 29th, 2014, shortly after your previous correspondence we discussed, right?
Yeah, it was about 3 hours after the first one, the one that I sent that earlier that morning.
address, Finance Exhibit 20. You would take a look at this document and then tell me, do you recognize it?
I do. This is the email dated June 4th, 2014 that I wrote to Maria Kingery in response to Plaintiff's Exhibit 19.
Is this a true and accurate representation of the document you maintain in your file?
It is.
I would move to admit Exhibit 20.
No objection.
No objection.
Admitted.
Okay. This is a fairly lengthy email from you to Ms. Kingery. If you would explain the substance of this email to the court.
Well, first thing I'll say is this is a communication from me to Mrs. Kingery. I'm not copying Fredy Alvarez on this. This is sort of an effort to say, look, here's the way things are. As I see them, and let's be reasonable, but still stick up for you. The first paragraph is a complete denial of everything she's claimed. It says that you've acted impartially, denying that there's a vendetta, that he's abusing you or abusing his position. She had claimed that you were not making timely decisions, and I pointed out to her that you had agreed with counsel for both parties. There wasn't a lot of sense in making decisions about the expenses until there were expense claims, until there was money in the estate to pay them. And it says, I've said that she's complained about my May 27th letter, but it tentatively approved 75% of your claims, subject to your giving us the documentation.
Did she address, I think in the next paragraph, she addresses an objection to run these claims. Is she still pending an objection against these claims at this point?
Oh, yeah. Yes. And she referred to that before. But the basic thing I'm saying in the fourth paragraph is, look, if without supporting documentation, you're continuing to object to what Mr. Hamberg has said about your brother's claim, and your brother continues to object to his position on your claim, we don't have any supporting documentation, this matter will have to be brought before the probate court for resolution, because as an administrator, the last thing you want to do ever is make a decision, hand out money, and have someone turn around and sue you for doing it wrong. Now, we talked about the documentation and how that went through, and pointed out on the top of the next page that Walter Hamberg, was selected jointly by the attorneys and by them after mediation. He's met with you all, and he's not favoring anybody. I've said that you're not entitled to regular reports of his time and expenses. You, Walter Hamberg, are entitled to be compensated as provided by law, and that is with the court, with the order of the court. And I said, other than the statutory commission, you're only entitled to such other compensations may be approved by the court based on a petition. No decision has been made about applying with this. But, you know, further on down, it says, look, he will apply, or he has to apply for fees, and when he does, you'll get all the time records and expenses and have an opportunity to have a hearing on that. I have also stated in here that I tried to put a strong paragraph in here about there's no basis for you to file or threaten to file a complaint or grievance with the state bar. He's doing his job as the administrator. He is a lawyer, but he's not your lawyer. He's appointed by the court. He's answerable to the court. And he's entitled to hire people to help him. And any compensation that's paid will be shown on the annual reports. And concludes in that paragraph, frankly, is my experience that efforts by heirs to supervise or control an administrator frequently necessitate greater time and effort on the part of an administrator that otherwise would have been required to handle on a stay. That having been said, Mr. Hamberg understands the stress inherent in family disputes and will always be open to any helpful communications or reasonable requests that you or your brother may have. And finally, I said, I know you have the right to go pro se, but this is a pretty complicated area of law, and I really think that you could benefit from having an attorney representing you. Part of what happens when I get involved in a case like this is to try to have a communication with an heir who is with a complaining heir or a disgruntled heir, just kind of clear the air and say, this is what happened, this is how this works, and try to be fair and accurate about it in hopes that everything will sort of will calm down. I also write these things with the idea that if you're fortunate, if unfortunate, the person who's receiving the letter or the email will take it to an attorney who knows what they're doing, then we'll look at it and give them some feedback.
And that is the source of this.
That is the
looking at Exhibit 22, we will be skipping over to 21.
Which we've already got.
There is no 21. This is 22.
It's already 10.
41.
It's already in heaven.
Oh, I'm sorry.
21 we already have.
Supplemental assignment of claims, and what it basically says is in communication related to your brother's claims against the estate, you're objecting to something alleging that there was a joint account and the account really belonged to Federico, not to Fred. And we've said in here, look, there's no case pending in any court that I know of. And based on the information that you have, Walter Hamberg is administrator, balancing the potential for recovery with the expense of litigation, he does not intend to pursue any claim against Fredy Alvarez arising from these joint account allegations. In fact, by that time, we had seen the joint account signature card, joint account right of survivorship. So we're basically saying, therefore, we're willing to assign these to you. Now, the letter is copied to Michael Deaver, to Craig Jones, and to Walker, to you. The copy to Craig Jones was to alert him to the fact, since he had a case pending already and was representing Mrs. Kingery in the state court of Fulton County against her brother, that this was a live issue, and he figured there was anything he could do about it in there. Because you did not feel it was worth pursuing in the interest of the estate, but it was to alert him to that possibility.
Okay, and did you receive any response from this Hamberg about that?
Yeah, I believe I did. I mean, I'm not sure if it's one of the things we identified or not, but one of the responses I got was, Mr. Jones is representing me in the state court of Fulton County. You have no business contacting him, don't contact him. So something that was intended to be low-key helpful with copies to all the other attorneys was really rejected.
Okay, I don't know if I can do this. Is this an accurate copy of the letter that's in your files?
It is.
And I would move to exhibit 22.
No objection.
All right, admit it.
Look at plaintiff's exhibit 23. You would take a look at this document and tell me, do you recognize it?
I do. This was an email to me and to you from Maria Kingery dated June 22, 2014. Also copied Carmen Caldwell and Jeremy Neisser, which is drawn. I don't think, I don't think the debtor's claim that you're talking about is the one that's here. I think later on in the case, Mrs. Kingery filed a petition for debtor's claim for expenses, claiming that effectively she was acting as the representative of the estate for several years and that she should be compensated for her time. That's what I see as the debtor's claim. I could tell you when that was filed, actually. But it's not this.
Yeah, that which thing is that separate from the $16,000?
That's separate, apart from the $16,000. It's about $8,700, $8,900. It was all settled in the declaratory judgment action. I think just based on the $16,600 number, what she's talking about here is her claim for a reimbursement of expenses.
Again, for the information court, how did you come by this?
How did I come by this?
Yes.
Well,
this came through,
and I think this was attached to an email from Maria. It's clearly addressed to me, and I clearly got it.
But at this time, do you recall whether Herman Caldwell and Jeremy Macy were still representing her?
I don't believe they were. Hang on just a second. I believe that they had withdrawn in early June, which is what they said was going to happen, and she had said, I'm taking on my own representation. I'm sorry, let me pick up on page 5. This was the part that I mentioned. In addition, I request once again that Craig Jones not be involved in this matter.
And to your knowledge, was Craig Jones still representing her in the state court action?
I thought so. I never had any communications with Mr. Jones other than to send him a copy of this letter, of that letter we talked about earlier.
It refers to plaintiff's exhibit 24.
Do you have a response?
I think he's responding to a communication from her. And he's entitled to infer what she's thinking and interpreting her writings. And he has to do that in order to respond.
Oh, well, he can give us an opinion about what he thought this communication meant.
I think you mentioned that this is a bullet point of response to items in that memorandum. Is there anything else in this item that's submitted to the board?
Well, I think that's it.
We're talking about 24.
That means it's 24.
For the first time, the second bullet point basically says gender doesn't have anything with this case, to do with this case. Mrs. Kingery had basically said in plaintiff's 23, I guess it was on page 3, that as an heir and beneficiary of the state, parens, even if I'm not a lawyer and I'm just a woman, I'm entitled to an explanation and see where his time is spent. And I was trying to say that the fact that she was a woman and not a lawyer didn't have anything to do with this or any position that you took. Gender was not an issue in the case. The next bullet point tried to explain the compensation, denies various things. It was really just an effort to respond to everything that she raised.
Yeah, let me ask you this, though, at this point. This is a long list of bullet points responding to the points. Was this a common practice as time went on in this case? Where you had to respond to various points that were being made?
It was, but it was not in letters. It was in pleadings and filings that Mrs. Kingery made. This was one of the last attempts to kind of our part to keep this off the record and out of the court. You said you don't have any money to hire a lawyer. Well, not long ago we just offered to distribute $28,000 to each person. So, and it does conclude by saying you should now be aware that Mr. Hamberg has filed petitions to resign as administrator of the estates of your mother and father, and we'll be following up with petitions.
And you referenced just now that this was an effort to head off the issues and problems. Following this, were there a lot of filings by Ms. Kingery that you had to respond to?
Well, there were, yeah. I had, once the petition for resignation had been decided on and had been filed, I kind of thought we were done. Then when Mr. Fredy Alvarez objected to your resignation, attaching the handwritten thing from the state court, it was like the dynamite went off. I mean, there were multiple filings in both the states that I had to respond to on your behalf. And it was all in pleadings in the record at that point.
And of all of these filings that you had to respond to, were most of those filings came?
Most of them were, by long shot.
And you testified earlier about Mr. Beggs appearing before the hearing on the declaratory judgment action, which of course addressed issues in part about these outstanding claims against the estate of both heirs. At that time, before that hearing, did you have any communications with Mr. Bates about supporting documentation for Maria's clients?
Absolutely. And they were provided. My suggestion was, show us the documents. We've been asking for them, and if we'll make a decision. So the documents were produced to us, I think, by Mrs. Kingery. And then, so we knew going into the hearing exactly what was going to happen with her claim, except that there was one thing we still had a question about, and Mr. Beggs brought that in on the morning of the hearing. You considered it, you approved it, and we approved roughly 90% of her claim.
So the communications with Mr. Bates and the production by Mr. Bates of these documents, is this just a few days before that hearing on the DAC action?
I think it was, yeah. There's a big time entry in reviewing all these records.
And so prior to the commencement of the hearing, was your testimony that there was generally an agreement with Mr. Bates about what this camera would be receiving?
I think that's true. I think that those agreements were stated before the court and declared for judgment. Now, I do not think Mrs. Kingery ever consented to your decision on Fredy Alvarez's claims, but she did withdraw her claim or the debtor's claim for additional expenses. So a lot of the declaratory judgment action when we finally got there was pretty well done before we got into court because we could see the documents that we needed. So I gave away my exhibits A and B, but I can do that without. If you were to look at exhibit 25A and tell me, what is that? Can I just tell you what 25A, B, and C are all at once?
Yeah, correct. Separately would.
These are time and billing records from my program. We use a program called Time Slips, which is old. If I were going to be practicing for another 10 years, I'd probably buy another program, but this is how this works. Plaintiff's Exhibit A is all of the time and expenses incurred in the case. Plaintiff's Exhibit B is bills, payments, and credits. And C is my trust account holdings. And I can, that's what they are.
Okay, and if you would tell us before how you generate those from doing the work to producing these.
Well, this is a system that I set up. I have timesheets that I keep on my desk, and I write in as I perform services. They're broken up into intervals, and I write in what I've done, what case it's on, my initials, and the time and tenths of an hour. At the end of the day, we turn them into a billing person, and who now comes in about once a week. She puts them into a computer program, and then we go from there.
Are these records maintained in the ordinary course of business?
Absolutely.
Do these records reflect an accurate representation of the work that was done and the expenses that have incurred in this case?
Yes, they do.
And what was your hourly rate?
Our hourly rate from the beginning of this case was $325 an hour. totals anything, my gosh, that's a lot. But this is over, well, basically, I've been involved in the case for basically 3 years now. And as I tell people in my contracts, we can't always determine what it is we're going to have to do. The court may require us to do something, other opposing parties may require us to do something. So yes, this is the time that I recorded, and I believe it was all reasonable and necessary.
And I mean, the summaries and the totals are all accurate.
They are. I can kind of summarize them if you'd like, because I really had to work hard to figure out some of these things.
I think it would be helpful if you could give the court an overview of the way that this panned out and how you did it.
Okay. If you turn over on 25A, page 16, that shows, I guess the top three-fourths of the page, it shows professional services rendered, 202 hours. That is, in fact, a total of all recorded time. It does not take into account no charge hours. It makes no distinction in terms of just listing the hours between, say, my time as an attorney and a legal assistant. So I've gone through this, and I have gone through it page by page, item by item. There are, in this 202 hours, there are 9.4 hours that are just no charge altogether. And there's 18.3 hours of legal assistant time, which was billed at 65 an hour instead of my 325. So my time was billed at 174.3 hours. Preliminarily, it was billed at 325 an hour. I say preliminarily because if you look over on 25B, the first entry is a credit to the billing adjustment of $2,440, which is a credit I gave on the first bill. In other words, I just reduced the amount that was being charged. And later down, I guess it's there's another place that says credit for $260, which was in November. There was some type of an adjustment credit I made, which was, it's part of the 202 hours, but it's not something that was billed. So when you get down to the end of all that, I can summarize it this way. There was a total of time. If you'll see at the back on page 16 of Exhibit 25A, $57,837 each. The adjustment of $2,444 and the adjustment of $260 brought that down to $55,133. You had given me a retainer of $3,500. I spent $8 of that filing entries of appearance in the probate court initially. I applied the other $3,492 to the first bill that I sent, leaving $51,641. Then you paid the first bill, the one that was in July, which was the only serious price I sent. I billed $6,304.35 with $20.35 in cost. You paid it in full, so I applied $62.84 to fees. That leaves $45,357 due as of July 7th. And there is $197.10 in cost that I have gone through and figured out that I was not reimbursed for a total of $45,554.19.
And that last number you gave is the amount that we're still doing.
Sure.
Yes.
Sure. Exhibit A.
Oh,
sorry. I just realized I have two A's.
I was going from memory.
Thank you. Man.
Yes, it is.
These do stick together. You mentioned that there were some expenses for paralegal. $60,000
an hour. Legal assistant. Yeah,
legal assistant. Was that done pursuant to your
Yeah, in fact, it was done by me. I just felt like it wasn't fair to charge full lawyer's time for some of those things. I'm coming out here to find something.
So you're the only person who will know this?
Yes. But I bill at lawyer rate, which is JWS, and LA, which is legal assistant, and that's the $65 rate.
I'd like to move to amend Exhibits 25, A, B, and C.
Mr. Alvarez?
No objection, Your Honor.
All right, admitted.
Is there anything else on the invoices that you want to bring to attention before?
No, I don't believe so. If you have other questions, I'll do my best to take it.
No, that's all right. That's all the questions I have.
I was just wanting to make sure the microphones were turned on. That's all. Thank you.
You're not. Thank you.
All right.
Mr. Spears, how many cases have you dealt with in probate?
About
hundreds of cases. Do you consider this case as being a complicated or simple case?
I will say that on its face, the issues are simple. You have to sell a house, you have to deal with a car, you have to deal with tangible personal property. When you get beneath the surface, it's not simple at all. There's been litigation going on between you and your sister that I have seen before I even got involved, since at least open in court since 2011.
And how many findings you have to deal with in this case?
A lot.
Didn't have a large number.
Well, up there, lined up in the middle of the desk behind you, are six notebooks. There are three full of pleadings for your mother's estate and three full of pleadings for your father's estate.
So it would be fair to say one in 60?
Well, some of them, I would say certainly 120. Now, you know, that list, just so you understand, that listed as a pleading is something, for instance, that is filed. I really wasn't listing leaves of absence and stuff, but if, for instance, there was a motion filed and then there was an order and I didn't have anything to do in between there, they're both listed, but they're not necessarily things that I had to deal with.
And did you have to, do you know approximately how many findings that Ms. Avery filed that you had to respond to? Approximately, no.
Yeah. Approximately. It's hard to say. I can say at least 18 or 19 in your mother's estate and probably 18 in your father's estate.
And when you were dealing with those findings, you also had to consult with your client.
Did it
correct?
Yes.
And your client had to dedicate time in order to resolve or accomplishing the response to that file.
Yes.
And those findings are in addition to the series of emails and correspondence that you had to send to her that you previously testified to and we have has been submitted into evidence.
My time covers all of that.
Okay. But the responses to the pleadings that we're talking about is in addition to these responses to the emails.
Oh, yes.
And to the letters.
Yes.
Did those filings, first of all, let me show you Exhibit 15.
Yes.
That's the letter that you sent to both counselors, as you previously testified. And in that letter, were there any claims filed by Mrs. Kingringer?
I think the claims that had been filed prior to that letter were you had filed a creditor's claim for reimbursement on your father's estate. Your sister had objected. She had filed a creditor claim for reimbursement on your mother's estate, and you had objected.
So there were claims and objections prior to you mailing the letter to the lawyers.
Oh, yeah.
And in that letter, did you propose a solution to resolve those objections and those claims?
Well, I stated the administrator's position on all the claims.
Yes, sir.
I asked for additional documentation. So rather than what I would say is I think we stated a path to resolution that we proposed, subject to production of documentation.
In other words, if I produce it, what you were asking, my claim would be resolved.
Not as long as your sister objected to it.
Subject to the objection.
And the same thing is true for hers. As long as you objected to hers, it wasn't going to be correct. Right.
But the letter said if you produce this document, the administrator would be willing to satisfy the claim subject to Mrs. Kingler's objection and the other way around. That's right. He said that so?
Well, in each case, I basically said, if either of you have any objections, let me know. Well, I think it was an effort to get there, but we didn't get there.
But the state was prepared to satisfy the claims at the right time if there were no objections or if the objections were resolved.
Yes, that's correct.
And I'm going to show you what I have marked as Fredy 1. Do you recall seeing that document?
Yes.
And how did you see the document? That is the settlement from the state court, correct?
It is.
And
I think what happened with this was I had filed petitions to resign in both the states.
Yes.
In June. And my recollection is that sometime in August of 2014, yeah, my birthday, August 25th, 2014, you filed an objection to Mr. Hamberg's withdrawing and attached a copy of this Fredy 1, this consent settlement agreement. And you basically said, I don't think he should resign because we've settled everything.
And did you and your client discuss the document?
We did, but I'm not going to reveal what we discussed.
Well, I'm just asking if you discussed the document. Were you under the impression that the case had been settled after reviewing the document between Mrs. Kingery and I?
I was under the impression that the state court case had been settled.
And the differences in this case, I'll bring your attention to paragraph 1.
The plaintiff and the defendant shall share equally the proceeds of the estate property contained within the estate of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez, less any expenses awarded by the administrator.
If
that led you to believe that the case had been settled, the objections, and the claims?
Well, one could certainly look at it that way. I have to say that, in all fairness, I don't believe your sister looked at it that way.
Well, I'm not asking you how she looked at it. I'm asking you, what did you perceive upon receipt of that document? As you previously testified, that the letter said, no, we object for the administrator to be dismissed because the case has been settled.
Well, here's how I looked at it, Mr. Alvarez. I looked at it, the state court case where everything had been assigned to you all was over. There was nothing going on, so that whole position that we can't make any distributions until the estate case, until the state court case is over, was done. That was gone. But the only thing that remained in this estate was resolving these two creditor claims. And it said, less any expenses awarded by the administrator. I did not personally read that as saying, and we consent to him doing anything he wants to do. I felt that he still had to do his job, he still had to take a position on the claims, and he still had to ask for documentation.
I understand that the documentation had been previously requested in this letter, in this with you letter, Exhibit 50.
It had been.
And upon receipt of that document, did you perceive that that has been resolved?
No. I had not. I felt this was saying the only thing left we've got to deal with is these two claims for reimbursement of expenses that you had submitted and your sister had submitted and both of you had objected to.
Was it on a statutory basis for Mrs. Kingery to object to my claim for reimbursement of the funeral expenses?
I think if you paid the funeral expenses, the law is clear that you're entitled to it. Her claim was an underlying claim that said, and you paid it from an account that should have belonged to my father's estate. You've seen our position in there in all the letters before, that we thought that there was not evidence to overturn the presumption that was intended to be a joint account with survival and that it was your money. Your attorney had provided us copies of the account card that showed it to be a joint account with right of survivorship, and that's why we said that should be proved. Now, saying it should be proved and actually paying it in a case like this are very different. Because,
what do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, for instance, if your sister is complaining about everything that you did and many things that my client did, feels that he is colluding with you, siding with you, biased against her, towards you, I can't tell him in good conscience that he can pay that claim that he acknowledges without a court order, because the court order is his protection.
I understand that. But was my claim for reimbursement of funeral expenses satisfactory to you after I provided the document that you requested?
Yes.
It's a payable claim.
I thought it was a payable claim.
Okay. And was that submitted to you shortly after you requested it in the letter in Exhibit
15?
15?
Yes.
Okay. The statement had been closed if we had agreed that if we have withdrawn the objections to the claims present, correct? At the time.
Look, if there were any point in the administration of this estate where you two agreed, it would have been closed.
Yeah. And that was in
sometime around August 2014. About?
Well, August 2014 was when you objected to Mr. Hamburg's petition for resignation.
Yes, sir.
I would say that by the time that we held the hearing on the declaratory judgment was held in, January 2015, we had the court order, we had seen sufficient documentation, and we proceeded to pay everything there was except Mr. Hamburg's fees and my fees.
So there was no need to go forward, continue these things as far as he has gone.
Well, I can't say that. I mean, your sister had said from the beginning that she was going to complain about Mr. Hamburg's fees and she was going to complain about my fees. So I thought that we would, I had hoped that we would be able to resolve these things, but we wound up back here for this.
Other than for what she said.
I will say that you responded, and if I read your document correctly in response to the court setting this for a hearing, you had stated that you understood, you had looked at and understood the claims that we had made for fees and for commissions, and that you were not objecting to them, but you were objecting to having to pay them all. You thought the payment should be skewed towards your sister's share of the estate.
Okay, well, that's what I have to mean. And also in some of your pleadings, you have asked for her to pay attorney fees, haven't you?
I don't recall that. I mean, it certainly could be, but I don't recall it. I'm not saying it didn't happen. I was pretty upset when I found that a state bar grievance had been filed against my client, and something had been sent into the court saying that it happened. So I might well have tried to say that should be stricken and maybe attorney's fees, but I didn't make a separate motion. It's possible, but we tried really to try to go right straight down the middle as much as we could and not take a side on this.
I understand that you want to be neutral, that you have done a lot of extra work that was not, didn't have to happen because her fight. Don't you agree?
I think it speaks for itself.
All right. Any questions?
Just very briefly, Judge.
All right. Brevity is appreciated.
Dr. Mr. Spears. A few questions for you. During your direct testimony, there were a lot of exhibits that were tendered that were communications from you and the screener.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, does that suggest that there were no communications with Mr. Alvarez?
Absolutely.
So of the communications that were had in this case between you and the heirs, 100% was to Ms. Humer?
Are you saying from beginning to end?
I'm asking you if there are documents in your possession that are communications to Mr. Alvarez that you've chosen not to make exhibits.
I first met Mr. Alvarez at the hearing on the declaratory judgment. At some point afterwards, he sent me an email saying, I intend to submit a claim against my sister for expenses or for having to do more work than I thought. I'd like you to be prepared to testify on that. I did not respond. I sent Mr. Alvarez a communication, a letter that said, not too long before this hearing, that said, your sister has claimed that you somehow purchased the house, the parents' house, through a straw man, and that you have colluded with Wesley Hamberg. And I'd like to know what your position on those is. And he wrote back and said no to both. That's it.
That's it. Now, you had testified just a second ago that part of the issue still pending before the court are Mr. Alvarez's requests or prayers for relief that he get a disproportionate amount of the estate based on some wrongdoing or litigious conduct on the Skinner's part. Is that your understanding?
That is my understanding. That's still alive and well.
That is an issue that's been today. That's Mr. Alvarez's claim. That's not Skinner's claim.
I'm sorry, yes, that's not Mrs. Skinner's claim.
With regard to, you know, part of the issues that were dealt with in the communications between you and Mrs. Kingery had to do with her requests for the amount of fees that the estate was incurring from the administrator.
Yes.
And I think you made your position clear that she really had no right to know, or she had no right to any information about it until the court approves it.
I think what I tried to say is the administrator serves under the supervision of the court. He cannot just take fees without asking the court for the fees. And that at such time as he petitioned the court for fees and said, I believe there will be extra compensation requested in this case, then all the time records will be produced and you'll have an opportunity to review them and come to court and have a hearing on them if you want.
Now, let's take it out of the context of an administrator. If he were a private attorney and he were billing a client, would you think it would be unreasonable for a client to call and say, well, Mr. Hamberg, where are we on fees?
Not at all. But he's not a private attorney representing her.
I'm not trying to argue that point with you, sir. But I will point direct your attention to plaintiff's exhibit number 2, which is the letter from Mr. Hamberg. I've had to mention this issue.
Oh, I got it right here. Thank you.
And it's clear in that letter that he intends to charge $300 per hour. And it's also clear that he intends to petition the court at some point in time for approval of that. Is that a fair statement?
Well, I think he says any fees and expenses that I incur, however I record them, will be subject to the approval of the court.
And I don't think we're disagreeing.
Okay.
But it clearly says here he intends to charge $300 an hour. He can't get it until the court approves it. I think it's the point that you're trying to make. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, sir, about it.
Well, I think the distinction I'm trying to make, Mr. Barrett, and I apologize, I'm not trying to argue with you, but I think how you keep your records and how you bill your records are related but different things. He's keeping his records, charging at $300 an hour, but none of that matters until it's presented to the court, and then only does it matter to the extent that the court approves it. But yes, everybody agreed he was going to keep his time at $300 an hour, and that was the basis of his billing.
Yes, but I guess where you and I must disagree is that she has no interest in knowing how the hours are accumulating that are initially going to be charged at $300.
I think that's absolutely right. She does not. In my opinion, because he's not her attorney one, and she does not have the right to supervise him. He is not her. He's not the errand boy, he's not the person who's there to take directions from her. And a lot of people don't understand that. And that's one thing you try to clear up early on in cases like this is, look, you don't get to tell the executor what to do. You don't get to say, or the administrator, you don't get to say, you write this letter. No, you can't write this letter. You have to ask my opinion to do everything. So no, he was not responding. He was not, I think it was perfectly legitimate that he said, you get to see the records before the court has any ruling on them, but no, I don't have to give you a monthly bill, a weekly bill, an hourly bill, anything. I don't have to tell you how much it cost for me to do this particular task.
And it's your position that as an heir of the estate, she has no interest in that information about how much the estate is being charged or is expected to be charged.
I think that she is interested, but I think that she has no right to that information until he actually petitions the court and says, here's what I wish to do with what I've recorded.
And do we agree that is a legal distinction in the probate code or in the fiduciary code? It doesn't apply to general practitioners working for a client.
Well, probably the two exceptions I see. One, if it's a contingency case, I don't think it matters. And two, if it's the other one just slid it away from me. But depending on what the fee agreement says, if it says I will bill you monthly, I will bill you at the end, then that's how it works. So I think, but yeah, in general, if you hire a lawyer to represent you on your case on an hourly basis, you're entitled to know what that lawyer's doing. Although you have to be reasonable. You can't be asking him three times a day.
We do agree on that. you had mentioned that the person has to go back to try to direct the administrator. I didn't see it, and maybe I missed it, but in the communications between you and Mrs. Kinger, I didn't see where she was trying to direct any conduct of the administrator. Now, I'll acknowledge and agree that she expressed general dissatisfaction, but I don't. Did I miss it? Is there something in there where she said, I think he needs to stop doing this or he needs to do this?
Well, I think one of the things throughout the thing is, why don't you just go ahead and approve my claims and disapprove Fred's? I think that was it. And I think in terms of asking for things when she wanted them, she wanted. Basically, my sense is, and this is my opinion, but that she believed in this case that she was entitled to get what she wanted, when she wanted it, how she wanted it, and that it was his job to do that.
But you can't point to any specific instruction that she gave him to do or refrain from doing any of this.
I can say that she gave him demands to produce documents and stuff like that. But you know, there's a thing. There's some stuff. I don't want to go back to the house, but there's some stuff back in the house about, you know, you were supposed to, you know, you didn't ask us to do this. And I think she felt that he was, I think she felt, as some people do, that the administrator works for us. And we get to tell him what to do. He's got to ask us. And I think it's pretty clear in the house that they were entitled to be consulted with. And in fact, they were signatories on the house sale contract. But it's pretty clear that they were to be consulted on some things, but not that they weren't driving the car.
Motion. All right, that's all the questions I have for you.
Thank you.
I'm very brief, just a couple of questions on this. One question.
Okay.
On what we were causing with, you remember right before the causing on the house, she sent the email we talked about earlier that she said unless the claims were paid, she would not go to the closing.
I did. And I was uninvolved at that point, but I remember seeing that.
Okay, you saw the communication, but that would, in your opinion, would that be something that would be where she was demanding and directing the administrator to do something?
Well, I think it was something where she did something that required you to respond to it.
Mrs. Mayor, a couple of questions.
Just a couple.
Just since 2014, I've noticed in the billing that most of the billing has been related to responses and dealing with Mrs. Kangaroo. Isn't that so? I would say more than 80%.
I have no idea of the percentage. It's a lot. I mean, After we petitioned the court to resign and you objected, the pleadings and the filings just exploded in this case.
From Mrs. Kinger.
Yeah, mostly from Mrs. Kinger. I cannot put a proportion on it.
Thank you. Keep stepping.
Thank you.
Thank you.